Welcome to the Healing Health Podcast. I'm Amber Petty. In this episode, I'll be talking to Professor Mari Botti from Deakin University's Institute for Health Transformation. We sat down to discuss her research around pain management and patient safety. She answers the important question of how do we get patients back on their feet quicker after surgery? So join us now in the conversation. So in this episode, we're going to explore your research on how we can enhance recovery after surgery, which is a very interesting topic. But first, I just wanted to give some context to who you are in your professor role at Deakin, but also your role at Epworth Healthcare.
My major role as a professor is to lead the Epworth Healthcare Centre for Quality and Patient Safety Research. So that's a joint position between Deakin University and Epworth Healthcare. And I direct the Centre for Nursing Research in particular, where we engage in clinician-originated research around issues in healthcare that affect the health service.
Let's talk about your particular research.
My research is very much around patient care delivery in acute care environments. So I research areas like patient safety, falls prevention, pain management, and patient experience overall. And in my role, I work with clinicians to try and find solutions for issues in healthcare that affect patient experience. And I supervise students in research programs around that area predominantly.
Let's break down some of the parts of the areas that you work with clinicians. So pain management, what's some of the research that you're finding around pain management and how, I guess, we can be supporting better?
Yes, well, pain management is actually quite a complex thing to achieve because there isn't really a objective measure of pain, and how people experience pain depends on their past experience, their expectations, the illness, the tissue damage that's involved, and it can be quite idiosyncratic, and it's a totally subjective experience. So when clinicians are trying to understand the pain of others, it requires an interaction, and it requires that patients are able to talk about their pain, and often patients are asked to give their pain a number on a scale of 0 to 10, and some people have not done that before, and they're not really familiar with scaling their pain and their experience. And often pain is in hospitals, in acute settings, is treated with opioids, and there's often concern about using opioids and fear of addiction and fear that patients will become over-sedated. So we find that in a lot of circumstances, pain is not well managed in acute care environments and that patients have unnecessary suffering. And so our role is to try and understand why that happens and to try to come up with solutions that help patients communicate their pain better and clinicians to make better decisions about the pain management that they offer patients in that circumstance.
What is what's an example of acute care?
Acute care is any episode of illness that it can be an episode that is exacerbated from a chronic condition, or it could be an illness that appears spontaneously, something like appendicitis or cholecystitis, where patients need to be admitted. Generally, people go into hospital because they need full care for a 24-hour period, and that care can't be delivered in their own homes. We do try to keep patients out of hospital because hospitals are not necessarily a safe place for people. There's hospital-acquired infection. People are in environments where they're not at home and they have a propensity to fall. They can develop pressure injury. Their mobility is reduced, so in particular older people, they're vulnerable to functional decline when they go into hospital environments. And hospitals are very costly places to be. So we encourage people to stay at home, and we are shortening their length of stay in hospital as much as possible.
So tell me about my stay.
So when people go into hospital, they're exposed to a whole lot of different clinicians. They're acutely ill, so they're not well. they're having medications that they're not used to often. They may be recovering from anaesthetic. They're having pain medications. And they're particularly vulnerable in that space. Mm. And it's very difficult for people to participate in their care and in their recovery in those sorts of environments. And it's a very unfamiliar place to be. So MyStay is a tool, it's an app that we've developed that is an attempt to provide people with capability to participate in their own care. Patient participation in care is considered an essential element of high quality care. It's now a national standard. So there is an expectation that health services will involve consumers in their own care and in their recovery. And so we've been trying to find ways to do that, and it's actually not that easy in acute environments. It's been certainly a mainstay of chronic illness management, that people are participants, they understand their illness, and they self-manage their illness. In acute health, we tend to do things to people rather than with them. And so MyStay was developed as a multimedia tool. We recognise that people spend a lot of time on their own in hospital where there is time to give people information, but they're not often in a place where they can retain it. If you give lots of reading, for example, people can't really take that in. But if we put it together in a very explicit, easy-to-manage multimedia app that people can just engage with when they want to, whenever they feel that they can, in small modules where they can take it in just small bites, if you like.
What are some of the small bites that are within there? Like if I'm leaving hospital, obviously I've still got an issue and a lot of pain with that. What do I need to know in order to sort of, you know, work with you as a clinician to get better?
Yes. Well, certainly in hospital, people need to know that that there's a certain level of pain where they can't function and they can't rehabilitate. Mm. So we're very explicit about what that number is, and then we encourage people to get assistance. So what we've found is that people are reluctant to use their call bell in hospital because they feel that clinicians are busy, they're going to bother people, that there may be people that are much sicker than they are. Mm. So probably about 11-12% of people would use their call bell to notify their nurse that they're in pain. The app tells them why it's important to do that. It's running now for patients having no knee replacement surgery and hip replacement surgery.
Oh, wow.
And we've just developed. Yeah.
What are the, what's the higher statistics of people having knee or hip injuries or replacements?
The number of people having those joint replacements is getting higher. So the frequency is higher and also younger because the joints now are lasting longer. And so but knee surgery is actually more painful than hip.
So really?
People experience more pain with the knee joint replacement.
Why? What is it? Because my mother has had several hip replacements, so I feel like I understand that more. And for me, knee surgery, is that from a fall, or is that like what are some of the big reasons why people have to have a knee replacement?
Probably the very main reason is osteoarthritis. Okay. So it's wearing down of the joint. And
that can be, is that brought on, like, am I more inclined, like, who is more inclined to have that happen, or is it a really sort of a physical unknown?
It's probably age-related.
Okay.
As people just age,
like the
their joints,
yeah, yes.
they,
okay.
Their joints. But it could be due to weight and sports injuries and other events. But generally it's a breakdown of the knee joint and or hip joint and requires replacement. And it's usually at end stage where no other treatment has been successful.
Mm. And they've obviously been in pain a long time.
Yes, they've had chronic pain condition. Mm. So, and that makes it difficult, again, in the pain assessment post-surgery, disentangling that acute pain. And many patients feel that they need to be stoic with their knee pain or hip pain after surgery because they feel that there's a means to an end, that now they've had surgery and that this is a different sort of pain. But there is some evidence now that if we don't treat the acute post-surgery pain well, that patients can go on to have chronic pain conditions due to that pain.
Oh, so that's tricky because you're dealing with individual people who are brought up differently in terms of being stoic, I imagine. And also, I know with my mother and her hip replacement, the level of hopefulness going into that is pretty high, I think, for most people. But also how you then turn hopefulness into, am I being on, like, you know, honest, or you know, that post, you know, pain kind of factor. If you're telling me, is it 1 to 10? You know, how do you know that I'm not just being stoic and saying it's a 7 when it's actually a 9 and there could be an issue? That's difficult.
It is difficult. And people have their own motivations for what they communicate to their clinicians. So some people don't want opioids. They don't like the effect that opioids have on them.
Tell me a bit more about opioids, because I've heard a lot of the opioids talked about, especially in America, but I'm not completely across what opioids are and the up and down side effects.
Opioids are narcotics. They're very strong pain relief medications.
Is it a Panadine Forte?
Well, Panadine Forte has codeine, that is an opioid.
Okay.
And generally the pain relief that's used that's opioid-based is oxycodone or endone, and that is used for short periods of time during high acuity pain. Is very, very successful in managing that pain. Mm. Obviously, there are issues. There is an opioid epidemic in the United States, less so here in Australia. But we do have to be wary about how we use opioids. So there are strategies in place to reduce that risk by sort of giving, when we send people home, that they have opioids in, they have a set number of
tablets. They've got their prescription, yeah.
Yeah, that they're not given a huge box of opioid and then to store for later and those sorts of things. So I think opioids are managed very well post-operatively here.
In Australia, given that they're managed.
Yes. And I believe that we should be using them as required.
Yeah.
And that people shouldn't be having high levels of pain after surgery.
And so are you saying that people, because of the bad publicity that opioids has gotten, much of it probably trickling from America, do you think that that's giving people fear that they're denying themselves the good side of the opioids, given the fact that it's monitored in this country and sitting in a lot of pain because of that fear?
I think there's always been a fear of using opioids.
Yeah. Even before.
Right. It's been a long it's been known for a while that people do fear becoming addicted. I think there's always a risk that if you don't monitor ongoing use, that people could become dependent on the opioids.
Yeah.
But really, what we try to do post-operatively is try to use as little as we can of opioid, but manage patients' pain appropriately. So we use Panadol and anti-inflammatories immediately after surgery, sometimes within surgery. And Panadol and anti-inflammatory medications are very, very successful post-operatively. Mm. And they are opioid sparing, which means that you can use less opioid. And then it's about good pain assessment immediately post-operatively and then watching that pain trajectory get less and less as people recover.
Mm.
So it's about good management, really. Mm.
So what are the other areas within MyStay that you're, you know, working with clinicians and obviously them working with patients in order to, you know, have that sort of post-surgery, you know, more effective and the recovery, greater?
Yes. So what we've done is we've co-designed the MyStay with clinicians and patients. Mm-hmm. We've asked them what they need, what they would like to know. We've looked at the care path that should be happening with patients, and then we've integrated that into these modules. So the app essentially has several different sections that patients can go into as they need them. So, for example, we have one section on pain management, one on preparing for discharge to going home. Mm. One section is simply on the goals for the day, so that you can open the MyStay and it's day two after your surgery, and it gives you quite explicit, easy to follow goals for the day for you to manage while you're in hospital.
What kind of things does that say?
So it's very simple. It's about how far you should be walking today, what's going to happen, sitting out of bed, say, for one meal. It's all part of providing the patients with a plan for the day that they can then control for themselves. So, for example, if they feel that they could sit out of bed for lunch, they can use their call bell and let the nurse know that they would like to sit out. Rather than perhaps waiting, hospitals are very busy places.
Yes, I was just thinking all of that.
Yeah, and patients can get inconsistent information. Nurses may not have time to go back in. If patients can feel that they can control their recovery, they know what they should be doing for the day, that they can then actually manage it themselves and call for help when they need it.
Yeah, because I was thinking also, you know, people's level of because there is, you know, hospitals are so busy and chaotic. And also, I think, you know, once you have a specialist or clinician come to you and they're telling you all sorts of things and you're trying to remember what to ask them and you're trying to retain, you know, the information, sometimes the basics can just literally go, now, what did they say about that? Did she say that I should be sitting out of bed for, you know, a meal, or did she say not to?
Yes.
Yeah.
That's right.
That's really good. So when you're sort of in a calmer space, you can go and say, okay, day two, oh, no, I can be doing that, or this is what I can expect.
Yes. Yeah, and not everybody's the same, and we make that very clear in the MyStay.
But
we sort of say most patients on day two are able to do this, and that gives the person a sense of control over their recovery. And another very important module is the exercise animations. So we've animated the exercises that they should be doing to rehabilitate that joint. So what we've done is we've asked the physiotherapist to act out those exercises, and then our animator has animated them. So the patient can then go to the exercises. So even though they may see the physio every day, they don't remember the exercises. They don't remember how often they should be doing them. And so this MyStay just goes through them with them.
Yeah.
So there's a voice, text and animation that they, so whatever they prefer, it's there for them.
And I would imagine from the clinician side, like say from the physio side, for something like that, the exercise, I would imagine, again, like, you know, I'm using personal references, but one thing that I would imagine that clinicians and specialists get a lot of, or, you know, all hospital staff, is the patient desperately going, where are they? Waiting for them to walk past. Can you tell me that again? I need you, which is really kind of like funneling everything into that very busy person, which is also probably a lot just to do with general fear and also a feeling of being, you know, disempowered, my body's letting me down and all of those kind of things. So what was once an empowered you is probably a very different, you know, version. So being able to go into something and go, oh, okay, yep, okay. And from what I was going to say, from the physio or the clinician to say, it's all there, you know, go and have a look at it.
Yeah.
You know.
Yeah. So that the MyStay is giving people the capability. They don't have to try to commit everything to memory, as you say.
Yeah, totally.
They know it's all there for them.
Yeah.
And they can access it whenever they like. What we really need, though, for true participation to happen is that they are given the opportunity to participate. So it is important for clinicians, for nurses, physios, to access the MyStay with the patients at some point.
Yes.
And to say, look, this is here and we're here to help you achieve this.
Mm-hmm.
And so don't feel that you can't call us because we look like we're busy.
And we're not just saying, here's an app, off you go, good luck with all of that.
That's right. This is to give you the sense of what's happening for the day so that then you can work with us. And, you know, and to make those important connections, because when we implemented it and we trialed it, we found that people you know, generally if their pain is high and they're trying to mobilize, they're worried that they're doing some damage to their new joint.
Yeah.
So they stop mobilizing.
Yes.
And we actually did trial. We ran a randomized controlled trial when we first implemented the knee joint replacement MyStay. So some patients received it and others didn't.
Yeah. Tell me a bit about some of the real, you know, the examples that you've got that of these trials.
Yeah. So this trial gave us the opportunity to randomly allocate patients so that there were no other factors that might bias the findings.
Mm-hmm.
And then we were able to see how people behave in relation to the key goals of recovery. Mm-hmm. With or without the MyStay assistance.
Mm.
And what we found was that patients who did have access to the MyStay had less pain during their hospitalisation. They were much more satisfied with their care. They had a better experience overall, and they were much more likely to recommend that hospital, that health service, to their family and friends for their for surgery. And very interestingly, they had one less day of hospitalisation.
Oh, wow.
So what that told us was that there was some impact of the MyStay. And when we interviewed patients as well, and we interviewed both the patients that had the MyStay and those who didn't, and those who had the MyStay were just much more activated in their recovery.
Mm.
They understood their goals.
Mm.
They understood how much activity they should be doing.
Mm.
They had a better understanding of their exercises. And really interestingly, they could articulate the connection between having good pain management and being able to do their exercises and mobilize.
Mm.
What we were hearing from the patients without the MyStay was a lot of sort of ambiguity about what they could be doing.
Mm.
Certainly reluctance to mobilize too much, to move or walk if they had a lot of pain. And they preferred to wait until they could see their surgeon.
Oh, and I can totally, I mean, thankfully, touch wood, I've never been in that situation, but I can, you know, I can now see absolutely, like, the risk factor or being brave and or both with doing that if you're not 100% sure that you that that's what they said and that this feels right.
Is this the right thing?
Yes, moving on this pain and this delicate area is what I'm supposed to be doing. I can really see how you go, I'm not going to risk that.
Yes. Exactly.
Because none of them would want to be in any more pain than the poor things have already been in.
And they don't want to risk the success of their surgery.
How will you change tomorrow? Design a future beyond your own. Design a future that makes a difference. Deakin's research students are the best and the brightest, with access to global leading researchers, world-class facilities, industry partnerships, and innovative research centres designing cutting-edge solutions that make an impact. Become a change maker. Become a Deakin research student. To discover more, go to deakin.edu.au/research. Deakin, more than a university.
What are your visions for a world that has a better surgery recovery rate?
I think we would definitely like to keep developing them. They're getting better every time we do them. So we've just developed the MyStay for cardiac surgery, which again captures more. We're better at working with patients to make sure that we're incorporating material that they need.
Mm.
So I think we'll get better at them.
Mm. So you'll keep branching out to different surgeries?
Yeah. We certainly will, and we definitely want to branch out towards covering the whole journey of recovery rather than that focusing on the
like a generic MyStay. A generic recovery piece module.
More so the journey. So the people should ideally receive the MyStay before they come into hospital, so they've had a chance to understand what's going to happen, and then they should be able to take it home and it. Hopefully guides them through their recovery at home.
At home.
And certainly there's the trends overseas are showing that patients are going to stay less and less. I mean, you know, for joint replacement, hip replacement surgery, patients overseas are going home same day, or the next day. And I think the trends are pretty much happening here.
And that's down to things such as, you know, what's in MyStay and the guidance and
I think it's more to do with trying to keep people out of hospitals and send them home earlier and give them home supports.
I see.
But in that means that tools like MyStay are even more important.
Mm.
So because people will have to rely on their understanding of their recovery when they're at home. And so we see the movement now towards developing these MyStays for the whole journey until they're fully recovered from their surgery. So we're working towards extending the MyStays. So originally the MyStay was about my stay in hospital, and now we're looking towards a my recovery trajectory, so that people can take these with them and use them.
And who do you need to support you on that to get that across the line?
Well, they're not cheap to develop, as you can imagine, because there's a lot of cost in the animations. There's a cost in producing them. So what we do before we develop them is we systematically review the best available evidence about recovery, so that we're giving good advice. We then have to test that content with clinicians to make sure that clinicians agree with that trajectory. And then we incorporate it into a language that then is well understood, so then we have to test it with patients.
And that's a whole thing in itself, isn't it, working out language that appeals to a range of, I mean, obviously you've probably got a certain demographic that's the higher end of, you know, who uses this, but essentially there are also different cultures and, you know, language is a very big thing, isn't it?
Exactly. And we, at the moment, they're English-speaking modules, but we can
Well, I even mean the tone and the words used.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
So the language, definitely. And now we're hoping to incorporate make them more multicultural, so that we've got a bit bigger reach for them as well. But then again, you have to test them and make sure that they are acceptable to people that are hearing them, and that they do communicate the way we expect they do. And so there's certainly the development costs, and then we need to research them and make sure that they are achieving what we think they're achieving.
Yeah. So will your research, you know, ongoing research with MyStay, is that something that you want, you know, funding for, either from government or individuals? Like, where does the money come that you need?
I think from government is an obvious source, because they are augmenting care and enhancing care.
But you're providing a really good solution.
Yes, we believe they're a very good solution to helping people participate in their recovery. And then, of course, we are always seeking research funding to actually test them and see whether we are, in fact, enhancing recovery.
So that you can further bolster your argument towards government. Well, fantastic, incredible work. And thank you for breaking it down into digestible pieces for me and anyone listening.
Thank you, Amber. Lovely
to chat to you, Murray. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks for joining in the conversation with us about our healthcare system. If you'd like more information on any of the topics or researchers in this series, simply head to iht.deakin.edu.au.